All right, hey, good morning, everyone. So homeworks, graded homeworks are up front. The exam's on Thursday, review tomorrow. I'll talk more about BlogForce stuff at the end of class today. So today we're starting into the last unit, so this material is not going to be on the test on Thursday. and this unit is about sort of motor control in general. Today we'll be talking about a little bit more about reflexes and spinal control of movement, a little bit of an overview as well of motor systems. And so the material for this unit is a little bit closer to some of the stuff in the textbook than a few of the other units have been, but it's not sort of going chapter by chapter, but instead kind of drawing from multiple chapters. And so the material ends up being spread across these five chapters of the textbook, but there's sort of parts of each of those chapters that I'll be drawing from for each of the different lectures. So by the end of the unit, we'll get through most of those chapters, and then also some other stuff, especially like the research articles that I'll talk about that go beyond that. But I've sort of organized the material a little bit differently than the textbook has. And so today we'll be talking about proprioception, which was originally planned to be in the last unit, but actually I think works out to be a little bit better over here, and sort of control of, and how that relates to control of motion. So proprioception is your awareness of where your arms and limbs and body and all your body parts are relative to one another. And it actually ties in a lot with motor control, because if I want to get my hand to a certain point, I need to know where I'm starting from in order to know which muscles to contract. So this is actually the full sort of overview of the rest of the semester. So today we'll have a brief introduction to motor cortex, and then talk about motor neurons and things called motor units, which is sort of a way that motor neurons and muscles interact. And work together to control movement. In the front, in addition to the homework, there's also the assignment sheet for Blog 4, which is also up on Blackboard. And at the very end of class, we'll have people start the process of picking papers, because the paper choices for Blog 4 are due Thursday night, but I don't. It doesn't really work logistically on an exam day to have people pick, get together with their groups and pick papers. We have the exam three, and then Thursday night is when your article choice will be due to Teresa for blog four, on the 18th. So the blog four stuff kind of all goes through Carnival Week, so you know, get to have fun with that, I guess. On the 18th, we have class. We'll be talking about the basal ganglion Parkinson's disease, which is one of the motor systems that I'll sort of briefly introduce today. Go into a lot more detail about the connectivity in the basal ganglia. And then the original post for Blog 4 is due as well. And then no class on the 20th, and then back on the 25th, the Blog 4 responses are due. Please don't be late on your Blog 4 responses, because in order to make space to give you time to also be working on your reports, I don't want to have that sort of extend beyond where it is, so that on the 27th we can do the Blog 4 recap. And so we'll be talking in class on the 25th about proprioception, reflexes, and other spinal control, so a little bit more depth about what we're going to be starting to introduce today. And then on the 27th, we'll be talking about the cerebellum, which is like the basal ganglia in some respects. It sort of helps the motor cortex accomplish its job, but it has some important differences in the way it works with the motor system. And then we'll talk about the vestibular sense, so your sense of balance, which is anatomically related to hearing, but sort of functionally much more integrated into motor systems. And actually also talking about eye movements and reflexive and visually guided eye movements on the second, and then the last day of class, will be about reproductive behavior and behavioral control and motivated behaviors. And that's actually the blog for research articles are about reproductive behaviors, and then there's also some other material about motivation and behavior, which actually ties back in a lot of ways to some of the stuff about the basal ganglia back there. And then that's the end of class. There's a review session in the evening on Sunday the 7th, and then the final exam is on Tuesday the 9th of May. Yeah, any questions about that kind of overview stuff? Okay, so actually before I dive into the material for this unit, there's one thing that is material that's going to be on the exam. And one of the reasons why I wanted to review it I guess because I didn't get a chance to talk to you about it. Another reason that I wanted to review it is because this is actually in a sort of logical way, very similar to what we'll be talking about with the basal ganglia. And since have the exam coming up soon, hopefully motivated to think about these systems. And actually, this is something that Dr. Barth spent a little bit less time on. So what she did describe is that if you suddenly stand up, then all of a sudden there's so as you're sitting down, your body's a little bit more sort of horizontal. As you stand up, then now there's a lot more gravity pulling down on your blood, and that causes a lot of blood to end up going to your legs just by like physics. And so as a result of that, there's a lower amount of pressure going up towards your head. So the receptors that sense stretch here are less active when you stand up. And so these are becoming less active. And then she talked about this one branch where there's all excitatory. So in the NTS, the nucleus of the solitary tract, there's less activity, so less acetylcholine, and so less parasympathetic activation, which means that your heart is less relaxed, and so you get more higher blood pressure. And so you should sort of be able to follow for this all excitatory, less. On the other hand, when you sit down, now all of a sudden there's the blood pressure going up towards your head goes up, and so this is more stretch, more active, more, and then we get more parasympathetic release, which relaxes the heart, and so compensates. And there were some practice exam questions about that. There's a branch to this axon. So again, when we stand up, less blood pressure means less activity here in the vagal ganglion, meaning less excitation here, less excitation. Now this inhibitory neuron is firing less. And so whenever there's an inhibitory neuron, then everything switches. So this inhibitory neuron's firing less, which means that the target in the rostral VLM that it excites is now more active. So more active here, and then more norepinephrine, which means turning up the sympathetic nervous system and increasing activity. This is logically kind of similar to one of the things that we did very early on in the semester when we talked about the excitation inhibition in eye movements, which is something that we'll also be returning to when we talk about eye movements, like I said a couple minutes ago in unit 4. And so this kind of like working through a circuit and figuring out when one thing goes up, what's going to happen to the next thing and the next thing and the next thing, or if something goes down and firing, what's going to happen to the next and the next and the next, and keeping track of excitatory and inhibitory connections and what that means in terms of firing is going to be very important in a couple contexts in this coming unit as well. But this one, this material is stuff that you should know for the exam coming up on Thursday. Yeah, anyway, so any questions about that before I go back over into stuff for the unit 4 material? Okay, cool. All right, so like I said, the plan for today is to give a sort of overview and introduction to motor cortex and central nervous system motor control. by the way, the central nervous system, by definition, and actually by embryonic origin, is three things. It's the brain, the spinal cord. Does anybody know what the third thing is that makes up the central nervous system? It's not the brain or the spinal cord by any chance? Yeah, it's retina. So when you look your friends in the eyes or whatever, you're actually peering into their central nervous system directly. Sometimes I get sloppy and I say central nervous system when I really mean brain, but I'm going to try to sort of be more careful about that. So central nervous system, motor systems does include the spinal cord. So we're going to talk about the brain and other motor systems in the central nervous system, including deep brain structures, brain stem, and spinal cord. Then talk about spinal motor neurons, and these spinal motor neurons, their cell bodies live in the central nervous system, but they project out to the periphery, where they make contact with your muscles. So once you leave the spinal cord, then you're in the peripheral nervous system. So all that autonomic stuff, the parts of it that happen in the brain stem were central nervous system, and then the parts of it that involved the parasympathetic and sympathetic ganglia that Dr. Barth introduced, that exists as these sort of, like, she called a secondary spinal cord for the sympathetic ganglia right outside the spinal cord. That's peripheral nervous system. Those are the two areas, or the sort of two main divisions. And then we'll talk about spinal control of movement and posture, and, like I said before, motor units and motor neurons, and how motor neurons interact with the muscles. So, sort of starting out our discussion of the central nervous system, starting sort of at the highest level, or definitely the most visible level, is the cerebral cortex. That is, of course, the sort of wrinkly stuff that surrounds your entire the rest of your brain. And we've introduced this a little bit before, but just to remind you, we have our four lobes: the occipital lobe, temporal lobe, parietal lobe, and frontal lobe. And so this stretch right here of the parietal lobe is primary somatosensory cortex, which is not a motor system, it's a sensory system. But it connects up with this other zone here, S2, and we've talked a lot about that last unit with the VPM and POM projections into both, or in VPM only into S1, POM a little bit into both, especially into S2. and then there's some temporal association areas. There's this one area called the lateral inferior parietal lobe, LIP. And so LIP, as an example, the lateral inferior parietal lobe, is going to make projections into the frontal lobe, into parts of, so switch over to, into parts of what's called supplementary motor area, or SMA. And in particular, there's a region of SMA called the frontal eye fields. And so the lateral inferior parietal cortex is involved in bringing together information, since it's an association area, which means it's connecting information from your body sense, including sense of balance and knowledge about your eyes and sort of the tension on the muscles in your eyes, together with vision and also a little bit of auditory information if there's a sound coming or something like that. So then the frontal eye fields are going to project into an area of, what color did I use for this? Red. M1, primary motor cortex. So supplementary motor area is sometimes called M2, most books call it supplemental motor area. Actually, it's premotor area and supplementary motor area, which I'm sort of lumping together. And then this is going to project down into the brainstem to the motor neurons that connect to your eyes. And when we talk about eye movements and the various things from vision to vestibular sense and knowledge of where you are in space that play into control of the eye movements, we'll kind of return to this and see that there's actually multiple different, somewhat redundant systems that control the eyes and control where you're looking. But this is sort of just to illustrate a little bit about like how these areas are all connected and how somatosensation and parietal association areas connect up with frontal premotor areas and then with motor areas in the front in primary motor cortex and then ultimately with motor neurons. For other parts of your body, there will be other the eye movements. It turns out are easiest to study in monkeys because. Experimenters, when they're dealing with monkeys, like to have the monkeys restrained for a variety of reasons, some of which is that they can, sometimes they're infected with stuff that you don't want to get yourself infected with, and so you have to be very careful. Experimenters sort of like to keep the monkeys restrained, and so it's very easy to have the animal move its eyes, and it's easy to track where the eyes are looking, and so we have a pretty good understanding in primates of how eye movement is controlled. And the idea is that similar mechanisms are probably going on for other motor systems as well. But that's sort of why this one's especially well mapped out. The big picture idea of this is that your somatosensory system and other sensory systems are projecting into the association areas of the temporal lobe, the posterior parietal cortex, the sort of area 7, which I don't, the area numbers are is very old nomenclature that I don't usually use, but you see a lot. From these parietal association areas, we get projections into the premotor areas and into motor cortex, and that's ultimately what's going to drive movement. So what questions do people have about that? In the 1960s or so, this guy Wilder Penfield was the football coach at Harvard, and then he retired from being the football coach and decided to get a second career as a neurophysiologist. And so he found epilepsy patients who were going to undergo surgery anyway, and started mapping out what goes on in their brain. And what he would do is patients are awake during these surgeries, and so he would either have the patients move or else electrically stimulate the patient's brain and ask them what they experience or see if any behaviors happen because of the electrical stimulation. And so what he found is that along this area that we now know in large part because of his work is primary motor cortex, when you stimulate up along the sort of more dorsal, up higher areas of it, then you get movements of the fingers primarily and a little bit of the arms. When you are more along the sides and down toward the lower areas, you get movements of the mouth and face. When he moved back a little bit further, then the patients would report feeling something in their hand or feeling something on their face, and that's how we came away understanding about primary somatosensory cortex. And in fact, if you remember back to the last unit, we saw that there's a body map in primary somatosensory cortex. It's mostly just laying down with the feet along the midline, body, big zone for the hand, big zone for the face, and then some areas for internal sensation. There's a very, very parallel map where, again, it's sort of like the body's laying down, feet, legs, torso, arm, big area for the hand, big area for the face, and then for the mouth muscles and as speaking muscles and so on, all sort of along this way here. If you remember the map of somatosensory cortex, then right next door there's a map of motor cortex. And like I illustrated here a little bit, there are projections from S1 to S2, some direct, some through POM. S1 and S2 will project into temporal association areas, which project forward to the supplemental motor areas. But in addition to all of that, there are also some direct projections straight from motor cortex and somatosensory cortex connecting them directly up with each other. And so the corresponding areas of the body will have these sort of longer path projections between them that allow you to make more complicated movements and bring together multiple senses from multiple parts of your body and multiple different senses, including vision and so on, into a complicated motor response. But sometimes, if something bumps against my hand, the first thing I should do is move it away. Some of that comes in the spinal cord. Some of that involves these direct projections from somatosensory to motor cortex that sort of bypass these higher brain areas. And actually, we'll talk more about the spinal cord in particular and what goes on with that either later today or next time. Okay, yeah. So what questions do people have about any of that here? Okay, so so from beyond the cortex here, so motor cortex, just to kind of finish this out, the mouth and or so the eye areas are going to project to the brainstem that connect to the eyes. Down here, we're going to have the areas that project to the brainstem motor areas. motor neurons for the rest of the face. And then up here, from sort of higher, physically higher, like more dorsal in motor cortex, we have projections out to the body. And there are some that go directly to the spinal cord. And others that go to the brainstem, and then from the brainstem down to the spinal cord. And so that is sort of captured a little bit more cleanly over here. So motor cortex and brainstem work together to figure out how to move your body. And there are actually more projections, not directly to motor neurons in the spinal cord. So I can contract one muscle, right? But a lot of times what my cortex is doing is not trying to contract one muscle, it's trying to do something complicated like type out a word or make a series of movements with my mouth to all make words come out. And so if my cortex is trying to accomplish that on a muscle by muscle by muscle basis, I'm too slow and not really able to do that. And so what the cortex does is sort of, you know, like the general giving orders for the army. It says, you know, okay, now lieutenant, you take your troops and get them over to this point. And the details of how you get them over there and how you navigate the terrain are left to these control neurons, these local circuit control neurons in the spinal cord. And we'll go into a little bit more detail about those coming up again either later today or next week. And then those make strong connections into the motor neurons that are then ultimately connecting up with the muscles. So for some simple movements, you know, if I just want to twitch one finger or something, then my cortex can connect directly to motor neurons that move the muscles. But for more complicated movements that involve moving my fingers in some complicated sequence or writing out something with my with a pen and paper, that involves my motor cortex and brainstem sending general instructions to local circuit neurons in the spinal cord that then actually accomplish the job. And there's sort of layers and layers within this as well of processing. So it turns out that there's probably a lot of the processing also involves motor cortex to brainstem connections, but those are less well understood in a lot of ways than the spinal cord local circuits, and so we're going to focus in on the local circuits again either late today or next week. But in addition to this, the cortex and its outputs, the other thing that's on this slide is subcortical regions. And so this is, again, part of the brain, but it's underneath the cortex. Not necessarily less important. In fact, very, very important structures. The basal ganglia and the brain, the basal ganglia and the cerebellum are very important structures, but they provide important controls and important inputs to the motor cortex, as well as into the supplemental motor areas. So we'll go into more detail about the basal ganglia next week and the cerebellum in 2 weeks. But for now, the basal ganglia mostly is involved in starting a movement. So if you just at a very coarse level, look at overall activity patterns as you do some complex movement. So something like doing a dance that you're familiar with or playing the piano, if you know how to play the piano. So you start your dance recital, and you do your memorized dance, and then you finish over time. And so this may take, you know, some sequence of dance moves that's 3 minutes long or something. What you'll see is that in terms of activity now in the basal ganglia and cerebellum, the basal ganglia is involved mostly at the start of the movement, and then the cerebellum is involved sort of for the ongoing control of movement, which is what's illustrated there. So what's sort of written there. So initiation of movement versus monitoring what you're doing and correcting or preventing mistakes during ongoing movement in the cerebellum. And like I said, we'll go into a little bit more detail about the basal ganglia next week and the cerebellum in 2 weeks. One other thing, so back to this image from my desktop background. So just like everything else, if the basal ganglia and cerebellum, since they're not part of the cortex, if they want to talk to the cortex, they don't make direct projections. Instead, they make indirect projections via the thalamus. And there's this one area of the thalamus in blue, the ventrolateral thalamus, the ventrolateral central versus ventrolateral outer areas of the thalamus. So the deep cerebellar nuclei, which we'll talk about as the output cells of the cerebellum, connect into the VLC. And then the basal ganglia, the substantia nigra pars reticulata, and the internal segment of the globus pallidus, which we'll talk about as well when we talk about the basal ganglia, are the main outputs. And they primarily project into VLO as well as VA. And then these VA and VLO, VLO and VLC project into the motor and premotor areas. Motor cortex and supplemental motor areas. VA, the ventral anterior thalamus, projects into the prefrontal cortex along with MD, the medial dorsal. And actually, when we talk about motivated behaviors, and actually you see basal ganglia, it's a little blurry maybe, but you see basal ganglia written here. When we talk about motivated behaviors, we'll talk about how the ventral anterior and medial dorsal hypothalamus, which again, sort of right now we're just sort of getting an overview, project into the prefrontal cortex and control motivation and motivated behaviors. But for right now, today, we're just going to say that these both project into the VL of the hypothalamus. And then to avoid getting too busy with my diagram, we'll just say that VL of the hypothalamus projects into M1 and supplemental motor area / premotor area. Which is all of this stuff here. And then this, the basal ganglia also project into the medial dorsal and ventral anterior hypothalamus, which are going to project into prefrontal cortex. And we'll spend a lot more time unpacking these couple in the next couple weeks, and then in the last week of class, return to this sort of motivated behavior information here. Okay, but for now, what questions do people have about all of that? Yeah, sure.
What is SMA?
SMA is PMA, premotor area. Yeah. So some sources call it mostly supplemental motor area. Some call it premotor area. Some say that the upper part is the dorsal part is premotor, and the ventral part is supplemental motor. They do have slightly different functions, but. That's one of the things that I tend to lump together. But just if you see supplemental motor area or premotor area. There are subtle differences between them, but for the purpose of this class, we're kind of lumping them together as sort of areas that are doing some further processing and coordination of movement for the motor cortex to figure things out. Yeah, what other questions do people have? Okay, so that's kind of the overview of the brain control of movement. For the rest of today, I want to move into spinal control of movement and a little bit about muscles in particular. So, for that, we will need spinal cord. So this is the spinal cord, sort of my the butterfly drawing of the spinal cord. And coming in, so this is dorsal, which just means back, and ventral, which just means the belly side of the spinal cord. The spinal cord is along the back of my body, but if I I'm like looking like this at you, then that would be a cross section of my spinal cord, and the part that's closest to the back is here, and then the part that's a little bit more toward my belly side is down there. And confusingly enough, because the nomenclature dorsal and ventral was named for like cats and rats and things that are on all fours, in your brain, dorsal means up and ventral means down. But in your spinal cord, dorsal means back and ventral means front. So again, you know, nomenclature in biology is never going to be easy. So we've already talked about a little bit about axons. Actually, here, let me color code these. Make it a little bit easier. Okay. Keep consistent here. So axons bundle together, and for touch axons, we talked last unit about, so for example, a pain. So pain touch axons make synaptic connections here, and then cross over, and then go up to the thalamus over here. Somatosensory axons travel up the same side of the spinal cord, and then in the brainstem make a synaptic connection and then cross over and go up to the opposite side of the thalamus. As we'll talk about in a little bit, a lot of somatosensory axons have a branch that also connects up in the spinal cord. Here, let me draw these as arrows. And then the bundle of axons coming in the backside is just called the dorsal root. And then there's this zone where all the cell bodies live, which is called the dorsal root ganglion. And ganglion refers to any collection of neuron cell bodies that is outside the central nervous system, which is one reason why basal ganglia is a terrible name, because it should be basal nuclei. But anyway, biology. So the axons coming out the back of the spinal cord are called the dorsal root. Then there's the dorsal root ganglion, where the cell bodies live, and that's the sensory information coming in. For motor information coming out, we have neurons that live in the ventral part of the spinal cord. They send their axons out and then actually end up mostly traveling together with the somatosensory axons. But on their way out of the spinal cord, they come out the opposite side, which is called the ventral root. And then these axons are going to make synaptic connections onto muscle cells. I'm going to draw it on the other side just to kind of avoid confusion, but there are some axons that are for autonomic motor control. By autonomic motor control, we don't mean movement, but we mean sympathetic and parasympathetic. And so for the sympathetic nervous system, again, these come out the front, and then they're going to make make a connection into neurons in the sympathetic ganglia. And then other ones might make connections farther away from the spinal cord in the parasympathetic ganglia. With the exception of the reproductive behavior stuff at the end, we're not going to see that much in this unit. But for this unit, there's no exam 4, so everything's going to be comprehensive on the final. And so trying to sort of see how all these things fit together is something that sort of trying to do as we go here. Okay, so but for this, we're sort of focused in on the muscle cells. And the muscle cells have their own sort of interesting and exciting physiology that involves actin and myosin. But for our purpose, all we really need to know about this is that when there's an action, so first of all, these are super strong synapses. So, and in fact, on one muscle cell, the axon branches a whole bunch of times and might make 100 points of contact with the muscle cell, which is sort of illustrated like right here, where this muscle cell is, where this axon is sort of connected up with this muscle cell and makes this big elaborate connection. When this neuron in the ventral root fires an action potential, that's the sort of final stage of control for this. From there, we are guaranteed to get a contraction of the muscle unless you've been exposed to some toxin that blocks acetylcholine receptors. The muscle cells always respond to the motor neurons. And so the control of our motor system is all about controlling when these motor neurons in the spinal cord fire or not. Yeah, so what questions do people have about that? OK, so let me draw another motor neuron here. So in a muscle, A muscle is actually not like your biceps muscle is not one cell. Your biceps muscle is tens of thousands of muscle fibers, which are essentially the muscle cells. And so each of these muscle fibers has input from only one axon. So the muscle fibers are sort of dedicated to just one motor neuron in your spinal cord. But the motor neurons get to have sort of their harem of muscle fibers, where they have multiple muscle fiber cells that each motor neuron connects to. In our muscle, we might have a couple muscle fibers that get input from this orange motor neuron, and maybe even more muscle fibers that all get input from this yellow motor neuron. And so this is kind of illustrated here. They've got a black motor neuron and a blue motor neuron, and each one of them connects up with a couple different muscle fibers. And so when this orange motor neuron fires, its two muscle fibers will contract. When this yellow one fires, all four of its muscle fibers will contract. Yeah, what questions do people have about that? So the term for that is a motor unit. And the definition of a motor unit is one spinal motor neuron plus all of its muscle fibers. All of the muscle fibers that it controls. And so this is another diagram taken from a different textbook looking at motor units and sort of they're color-coded here. So motor unit 1 is this red motor neuron, and then all of the red muscle fibers that it connects to, and then the blue motor neuron and all of the blue color-coded muscle fibers that it connects to, and the purple motor neuron and all the purple color-coded muscle units muscle fibers that it connects to. And so there are three motor units because there are three motor neurons, and each motor unit has one motor neuron plus more than one muscle fiber. There are some motor neurons that connect to a single muscle fiber, and some motor neurons that connect to many hundreds of muscle fibers. And this is quite useful for a variety of reasons. So when I'm drawing on the board, I'm kind of using my shoulder, but there's not much weight that my, I've just got this little piece of chalk, that my shoulder is moving. And so having the ability to not like make a big line like that because my shoulder contracts like crazy, and being able to do something where I can write smaller is valuable for me, that I can make small movements with low resistance, low weight, low mass that I'm moving around. On the other hand, I also sometimes we need to pick things up that might be somewhat heavy. And so having some motor units that are dedicated to moving many, contracting many muscle fibers all together is also quite useful, because if I had to have, if all of my motor units were just connecting up to individual muscle fibers, then I would need a ton of neurons to make these big movements that I need. And I want to be able to make these big movements much easier. And so that's sort of the idea of controlling force, and the book describes that as well. It actually has a couple different figures about that, where it shows the force plotted in black, and then the activity in terms of spikes per second of different motor neurons, and how as you are increasing the force, you might first recruit one motor neuron and its and all of its muscle fibers, then recruit a second motor neuron and all of its muscle fibers, then a third, then a fourth, then a fifth, then a sixth. And so if you have to provide a lot of force, you might be recruiting a lot of big motor units with many muscle fibers associated with them. And if you need to make very fine movements, then you might be just modulating and changing the action potentials of one or two motor units. One or two muscle fibers controlled by a couple small motor units, meaning motor units that have very few inputs to them. Okay. One other place where motor units are helpful is, so you know, I have to spend an hour and a half standing up, and I don't want to collapse during that course of an hour and a half. And so my back muscles, and if I'm in better shape, my ab muscles too, would be kind of have a little bit of tension in them as I'm up here. And I need to sustain that for long periods of time. But it turns out that the muscle fibers just physically can't. They get tired. So let's try and take, I don't know, let's take like 3 minutes and just kind of discuss, you don't even have to take notes on this, but how you might use the idea of motor units to prevent fatigue. So I've written up here that you prevent fatigue. Try and discuss for 2 or 3 minutes how having multiple motor units controlling my back muscles, for example, might keep it so that my back muscles don't all fatigue out and I collapse over the course of an hour and a half, where the muscles can only stay contracted for maybe half a minute at a time each. So try and sort of brainstorm ideas about that with whoever's around you, and then we'll come back and talk about it as a group in a couple minutes. Okay, it sounds like most of the groups have finished up with the discussion. So who even want to share what their group came up with in terms of this? I saw your hand go up, Chloe, even though you weren't going to share. What did you come up with?
I was just saying that maybe the motor units are intertwined this way. And then I saw the diagram, which was what I was pointing at.
Yeah.
So that instead of like activating two different parts of a muscle, you'd be activating the same parts but alternating.
Yeah, exactly. So that's exactly what they do. So the muscle fibers were fatigue, and so I like the way you did that. Instead of being my arm muscle, this is my back muscle. There's intrinsic differences between arm and back muscles, which if you take physiology, you'll get into where they're actually the muscle fibers themselves are a little bit differently sensitive to fatigue. But even that aside, at some point, the back muscle motor units, muscle fibers will fatigue, and so maybe first. If this was my back muscle, first we activate the red and give the purple and blue a break. Then as the red starts to fatigue, we start activating the blue motor unit. And so the red gets a break, gets a chance to recover from the fatigue, and the purple's still on break, and then the blue's taking a turn. And so they sort of work in shifts. Then the purple takes over as the blue starts to fatigue. And then finally, as the purple starts to fatigue, now the red is ready to go again, and the red takes over. And so by taking turns like that, the cellular physiology that contributes to fatigue, which by itself is an entire hour and a half lecture, doesn't build up to the point that any of that my muscle as a whole physical structure ever loses tension, even though at any moment in time only a fraction of the muscle fibers within it are contracted. Now, if instead of just holding up my own weight, I had, you know, three people stacked up on my shoulder, then I would need to be generating a lot more force in my muscle, in my back, and I would fatigue much more quickly because my motor units would all be having to work on shorter, faster shifts, and so that fatigue would build up. But my back is strong enough that I can maintain, hold up my own weight for quite a long period of time without my muscles fatiguing away by this sort of taking turns thing. Okay, so yeah, so what questions do people have about either anything about motor units or the motor neuron to muscle connections? Yeah, sure. Yeah, so a few things. Mainly, as you exercise, your body will build more muscle fibers, and then the existing motor neurons connect into those. So you don't get more motor neurons, but as you exercise, your body can grow new muscle fibers. That's the main aspect of it. There's also then like strength training versus endurance training, and most of that has to do with whether you build more what's called white muscle, which is fatigue resistant but a little slower to activate, versus red muscle, which is stronger but fatigues more quickly. And so as you train in anaerobic versus aerobic conditions, you're building up, actually I got that backwards, the red muscle is fatigue resistant, the red muscle is fatigue resistant, the white muscle is fast fatigue. Anyway, yeah, you build up those different kinds of muscle fibers. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, to be honest, yes, it's like somehow the axons branch, right? And new muscle fibers are born. There are stem cells that can create new muscle fibers embedded within your muscles. And then, so early in development, what I've seen a lot of studies about is very early in development, you might have a couple different motor neurons connecting up to a single muscle fiber, and there's this competition that they undergo so that one wins out. And then by the time you're sort of a 1 year old or so, all of your muscle fibers have one input. I don't know for the new ones that are born whether they have the same competition or whether it's just the closest axon or what controls that. That's a good question. I really have no idea. I'll see if I can find something about that. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Yeah, so we have, well, that's a good question that kind of leads into the next topic. There are many different kinds of neurons. A whole bunch of neurons in sort of the intermediate layers of the spinal cord, some of them might inhibit one another, some of them might excite one another, some of them might make direct excitatory connections or direct inhibitory connections onto motor neurons. And so one version of taking turns that we're actually going to spend a little bit of time on for the next 20 minutes is walking, where I need to sort of take turns between my legs, and also within a leg I need to take turns between extending and contracting, extending and contracting it. Similar principles are involved in sort of taking turns between these motor neurons for sustained contraction. It's been best studied in walking, in part because there's a lot of funding comparatively for that, because it has implications for people who are paralyzed, or people who have central like brain deficits like Parkinson's or ALS, where their brain isn't able to control their muscles as well, but the spinal cord is mostly still working. And so understanding the ability to walk and how that's controlled at the spinal level has some implications. Plus, walking is a more visible, measurable behavior than the alternating motor units, which is a little bit harder to keep track of. But the idea is that similar principles, as we'll be talking about in a minute with that. Yeah, what other questions do people have? Okay, yeah, so then this leads right into the next question, which is sort of spinal control of movement and posture. Actually, I'm going to skip ahead a little bit to talk about one thing really quickly here. I do want to get into the spinal control of movement and posture pretty soon, but some of the sensory neurons that you have actually sense your muscles, and we'll talk about that more in a couple class periods. But they sense the tension on your muscles and the amount of stretch on your muscles. And so if the doctor hits your knee, it stretches out your quadriceps muscle, and so as a result of that, that is going to have a direct, so that input goes up to your brain, just like touch input does, but it actually also has a direct projection onto the motor neurons to excite them. And so that's sort of the simplest kind of spinal control. And then there's also an indirect inhibitory projection onto the motor neurons that would be exciting the opposite muscles. So when the doctor hits your knee, it stretches your quadriceps. So your quadriceps muscle quickly contracts because of this direct projection, and then also very within a millisecond or two, as the quadriceps starts contracting, the hamstring starts relaxing, and so you have this kick that you do when the doctor hits your knee. So that's sort of the simplest version of a spinal control of motor, and we'll talk more about that when we go into proprioception and the different kinds of sensors that sense where your body is in space. But slightly more complicated versions of this involves the motor neurons that are controlling walking. And so one demonstration of this is cats, which have had their spinal cord cut. And then actually what's not shown in this cartoon is these cats are suspended by a harness, because with their spinal cord cut, they won't stand. But if you keep them suspended on their harness with their feet touching this treadmill, then you start the treadmill moving. As the treadmill moves, the cat will start walking on the treadmill. And you'll see the extensor muscles, which are the cat equivalent of the quadriceps muscles that extend the leg, contracting, and then the extensors relax, and the flexors contract, and so the animal flexes its leg, and then the extensors take a turn, and so kind of similar to a human, the cat sort of extending and flexing its leg to take steps. And in fact, humans, so this is a woman who's got a similar injury to this cat, probably a car accident, I don't actually know, but where her upper body, she can still control her arms, but her legs, she's paralyzed, and if she's suspended from a harness and put on a treadmill, then her legs will walk on the treadmill. Without any input from her brain, and so your brain isn't necessary for walking, at least in terms of there are ways to get your body to walk without your brain. So if I walk, I sort of send a command down to make my spinal cord system for walking get activated. But then also, you know, I can walk and carry on a conversation because once I get going, I don't need to constantly be providing, okay, like left foot, right foot, left foot, right foot. I just go and my spinal cord takes care of the whole thing. Yeah, questions about that? Yeah, sure.
Does that matter whether you have spinal cord?
If you damage it at the lumbar spinal cord, where the motor neurons themselves that control the muscle, the legs are, then that'll actually cause physical damage to the motor neurons. So what we want to do is disconnect. I guess one thing that I didn't show in that diagram. Um, is that coming down from your motor cortex and brainstem are some excitatory connections like this from your brain coming down. And so what for this, you need to cut those axons without damaging these cells in the spinal cord at the level that control at the sort of level of the spinal cord that controls the legs. But in terms of whether it's somebody like Christopher Reeves who had spinal cord injury that left him completely paralyzed from the neck down, or somebody like this woman who's paralyzed from the waist down. The suspension on the treadmill and the ability to walk works for both. So all you need is the local spinal cord within that sort of area that controls your legs. Other questions about that? Okay, so how this is accomplished is sort of by this process of what's called reciprocal inhibition. So we've got some input, and that input, so draw our spinal cord again. So we've got some input, A, and that input can either be a local neuron here within the spinal cord, or it could be coming from the brain, or it could be some sensory input. And then that input is driving this B1 and B2 level neurons. And these two neurons have what's called reciprocal inhibitory connections. So they're each inhibiting each other. And then in addition to that, they also are inhibiting some motor neurons, so C1 and C2 down here. And then actually really one thing that's left out is that we probably have to also have some excitation on these so that they're going to fire when they're not being inhibited. And so what this So this A to B1 and B2 connection accomplishes is that with constant drive on these two cells, one of them, by chance, basically, is going to win out and start firing first. And then it's going to inhibit the other. But at some point, this cell might start to have more and more sodium channels and activate it. If it's firing at a high frequency, then some neurons start to build up sodium channel and activation. Or there might be other things involving calcium signaling in this neuron, maybe this neuron has some hyperpolarization activated channels. There are a lot of different ways to accomplish this. Things that if you take cellular neuroscience, you go into a lot about. But what happens is in this network, one neuron wins out, and then a sort of predictable time course based on the internal properties of these cells, that neuron's going to slow down, and then this neuron is going to start firing. And then once it starts firing, it's going to inhibit B1, and then it's going to eventually slow down, and then B1's going to start firing. And so what we get is this alternating pattern of B1 active, then B2 active, then B1 active, then B2 active. And in fact, we can even get a little fancier about this and change some of the internal facts about these neurons and whether they have certain calcium channels or not to make it such that B1 is active for a long-ish period of time of a half second or so, and then B2 is active for a tenth of a second, and then B1's active for half a second, and then a tenth of a second. And so we can get a long period of extension followed by a brief period of flexion and then a long period of extension too. But sort of stepping back, the big picture of this is that by inhibiting one another, these neurons are creating a system where they're taking turns firing. And so as they're taking turns firing, the motor neurons that they're connected to will also take turns firing. Because these are inhibitory neurons, B1 is going to fire when B1's firing, C1's off and C2's on, and then vice versa. But we've created now, with basically five neurons, a system where we have two motor neurons that are taking turns. And so this one might connect out to our hamstring. And this one might connect out to our quadriceps. And so we're going to take turns between swinging our leg forward, planting it, and then bending it, and then swinging our leg forward, planting it, and then bending it, and all locally with just a handful of neurons be able to move a leg in walking. Yeah, what questions do people have about that? Okay, so the spinal cord is, in fact, can do a lot of things, and even just again with these two neurons that connect to our quadriceps and our hamstring, we can do even more complicated things that might be sensory driven. So if you step on a tack or step on something hot, and you have some pain input, some sort of fast pain input coming in like this. Then that fast pain input it gets a little bit busy because there's many hundreds and hundreds, thousands of cells in the spinal cord. That fast pain input might branch and activate, let me make sure I get this right, activate an excitatory interneuron that's going to ultimately connect up with your hamstring, so like this, and then activate an inhibitory interneuron that's going to connect up with your quadriceps. And so you step on something and the hamstring contracts, so you bend your leg, and the quadricep relaxes, so you bend your leg. And so as you step on something, you lift your leg up. There's actually control of connections up between levels to also move some of your hip muscles and other things too. So this allows you to have other things that your brain doesn't need to control. And in fact, it gets even more complicated than that, because when I step on something hard, sharp, or hot, or whatever, not only do I need to bend this leg, but I also need to tense up the other muscles on my other leg so that I don't fall over as I pick up this leg. And so as a result of that, I need to connect to neurons that are going to inhibit the hamstring of the leg that didn't step on something, and tense up the quadricep of the leg that didn't step on something, so that my leg is ready to bear the extra weight and keep me from falling over as I pick up the one that just stepped on a tack. And so these connections can get quite complicated and cause this interactions between the two sides. Yeah, so what questions do people have about that? Yeah, sure.
What about slow pain?
Yeah, so slow aching pain doesn't connect up directly to these circuits. It can modulate things like inflammation and longer term behaviors. But for sort of the quick, like within less than a second, getting away from the pain thing, those axons are too slow to give you any information relevant for that. Okay, so considering this, so back to walking now. When I walk, not only do I need my right leg to take turns between extending and flexing and extending and flexing, but while my right leg is extending, I need my left leg to flex, and then while my left leg is extending, I need my right leg to flex. For the next 6 minutes or so, try and combine what we just talked about with the walking reflex and what's shown here to show, instead of sensory driven from pain, now we'll imagine sort of descending motor control landing on some control neuron in the spinal cord, and then that one control neuron needs to create a system where you're going to alternate walking with the left leg and right leg, left leg and right leg. So we'll have until about 10:16 to work on that. And this one, you should write down names of everybody who works in your group and turn it in at the end of class. We'll start class next week reviewing that. So CPG means central pattern generator.
Thank you.